Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and salvation to them that believe, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." I said, I know what the book of Hebrews said in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. It said, "The word of God is quick in power, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the binding of sunder of soul and spirit and joint and marrow, as a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart." I know what David said in Psalms 118, verse 24. He said, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." But I said, there's a reason why I love to praise him. See, God saw the best in me when others saw the worst in me. See, there was a time when I was classified and identified by a number. A number that I would never forget. 237-25-112. But I'm so glad that I got introduced to grace and fell in love with mercy. I said he saw the best in me when others saw the worst in me. While I was yet a sinner, he died for me. So the reason why I love to praise him is because he's done so much for me. See, I know that he's been a wonderful Savior to me. So while the blood runs warm through my veins, I'm going to praise him. So I thought I'd just start off with that this morning, but I'm fired up.
Yeah.
I'm fired up this morning. I'm thankful for the leadership for allowing me to come here this morning. I'm thankful for Sister Coates for calling my name in the pot. I really appreciate that. I feel like I'm at home. I started in Corona.
Yeah.
August 24th, 2008 is when I gave my first sermon, and it has opened up my eyes and my heart completely, and I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for the relationships that I developed with a lot of the members here at Corona. You know, I feel and believe that we're family. And I'm thankful for that. Also, I'm thankful that if God says so, tomorrow will be in my wife's anniversary.
Amen.
So y'all need to give us a hand. One thing about the devil will do everything he can to get you in bed before marriage, and he'll do whatever he can to get you out of bed when you marry. So when we hit that milestone of anniversary, I think we need clap. We're going to start at Mark chapter 5, and I'm going to end with Philippians 3:14. I won't be long this morning, but I'm going to try to make my points as much as possible this morning. And we're in Mark chapter 5, we're going to start at verse 25. Okay, the Bible said, "And a certain woman which had an issue of blood for 12 years has suffered many things and many positions, and has spent all she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she heard of Jesus, she came and pressed and touched his garments. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself the virtue had gone out of him, turned and pressed and said, who touched my clothes? And the disciples said, thou seest the multitude throng thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked around about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague." I like the title of this sermon, "Lord, I need you to help me." of this woman having this blood for 12 years. See, the Bible and Old Testament text, it gives a timetable if you have this blood for 12 years. And you know what Paul says in Romans chapter 15, verse 4, whatsoever things is written aforetime is written for our learning, that we can face the comfort of Scripture might have hope. So let's go back to Old Testament text and get some Old Testament information. So if you can, let's turn with me to the book of Leviticus, chapter 15. Leviticus chapter 15.
And if a woman have an issue, and her issue in her flesh be blood, she shall be put apart 7 days. And whosoever toucheth her shall be unclean until the evening. And everything that she lieth upon in her separation shall be unclean. Everything also that she sitteth upon shall be unclean.
So this woman had this issue 12 years. What we see in the book of Leviticus, if you have an issue of blood, they say, okay, 7 days to be apart. But anything that touches her or she touches is considered unclean. But the Bible says she had this woman, this issue, for 12 years. So I wanted to go a little deeper. That's 4,380 days. 4,380 days, I can't be in fellowship. I can't go to the pop-up. Won't nobody call me. Won't nobody answer my calls. Because anybody that touched me is considered unclean. Anybody that I touch is considered unclean. So you know this is weighing down on our emotional mindset, our psychological mindset, tearing her up spiritually. I can't be in fellowship. I can't be in worship because I have this issue. But then you see that just because she had this issue, she wanted to be made whole, because the Bible says that she spent all that she had by these doctors, and this situation got worse. You know how we try to heal our finances, and we try to get into these get rich schemes, and we spend all our money with Bonnaby and Mary Kay and Cutco, and everything is fall apart. You know how we try to build our family relationship, and we'll try to get a Joel Osteen book. We'll wake up and we'll listen to the Counterfeit Dollar Ministry, and then we'll wake up in the morning and we'll try to listen to Joel Osteen. Joyce Myers. Now keep in mind, this woman was desperate, and she had this issue, and she wanted to be made whole. These doctors knew they couldn't heal her. They took her money in. But she had a desperate act because she wanted to be made whole. She was tired of being sick and tired. But her resources wasn't good enough. But then watch this. The Bible says she heard of Jesus. See, we don't understand the importance of a testimony. What did she hear? Let's go back to the Bible. Let's go back to Mark chapter 5. Let's go up to verse 18. Because she heard something. Mark chapter 5, let's start at verse 18. The Bible says what?
And when he was come into the ship, he that had possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but saith unto him, go home to thy friends, and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and hath compassion on thee.
She heard about what Jesus did to this man who was in this cave, that people said, man, this dude is crazy. We're going to put chains on him. We're going to lock him up. But when Jesus came in counter with this man, he got out these lesions out of him, these demons out of him. She heard about that. Wait a minute. God delivered you from this situation. He can do that for me. But see, what I'm going to you guys, when you at work, are you sharing what God has delivered you from? When you at school, are you sharing what God has delivered you from? Because there's some people in here that have issues. And she had this issue and she was desperate. Man, I'm tired of being isolated. I'm tired of having this cover over my head. I'm tired of people identifying me, the woman with the issue. I'm tired of being like this. I'm tired of being identified as a husband who don't provide for his family. I'm tired of this issue. So she heard about Jesus and said to herself, if I can just touch the hem of his garment. But she knew anything she touches is considered unclean. wanted to see some accountability. See, I want you to know the issue that you had is not your issue anymore. See, I want you to know that I'm the one who delivered you from this issue. Now, let me show you something. The two things that we have to do in order for God to do something else. The first thing we have to do, we have to make a full decision. We have to make our mind. We have to stop leaning to our own understanding. You have to make a full decision. I got to go to Jesus. And after you make a full decision, you have to make a full departure. I got to leave some things. I know this situation right here is causing me to be in this issue. I got to leave this. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 11. And we'll start at verse 28. I have to make a full decision. After I make a full decision, I have to make a full departure. This woman made a full departure. The Bible says what?
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls.
He said, all ye that labor and heavy laden, come unto me, I'll give you rest. See, this yoke that you got on you, these issues that got on you, they too much for you to bear. He said, take my yoke and learn of me, for I'm new in me, and me, meek and lowly. You need to learn of me. See, I can give you rest. See, this issue that you have is messing you up. I can give you what's called a peace of mind. The Bible says in Isaiah 26 and verse 3, if you keep your mind still on me, I'll keep you in perfect peace. See, sometimes we allow our circumstance to dictate how we're going to serve God. Man, everything is going bad. I'm just in a bad mood. You know what? I got laid off the job. I don't feel like coming to worship because I'm just so depressed. Come on to me. After you make a full decision, you make a full departure, I'm going to the source. I'm going to the one who can heal my issue. Because first I identified and I realized I got an issue. I got a lying issue. I got a doubtful issue. I got an anger issue. I got a stealing issue. I got a backbiting issue. I identified I got an issue and I'm sick and tired of being sick. After I identify I have an issue, I make a full decision. I make a full deposit. Now watch this. After you make that full deposit, I'm not talking about a halfway deposit. I'm talking about a full deposit. You watch what God will do. Turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. It's an Old Testament text. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, the Bible says,
if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land.
If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves. See, I noticed that when Noah built the ark, he made one door. The giraffe had to humble himself and bow his head to go through that door. Noah didn't make a separate door for the giraffe. So in order for us to get healed, we got to humble ourselves. But sometimes we got so much pride and boastfulness. We got to humble ourselves. Man, I got an issue. And I know God is the one that can save me from this issue. I don't care what they say about me. Lord, I don't care about what you say about me. Why do you call me Lord and you don't do my will? I care about, Lord, what you say about me. But if I humble myself and turn from my wicked ways, the Bible says, then you will hear my prayer. she may be your family, may be hurt. And you may not be the husband you should be. You need to make a full decision. After you make that full decision, you need to make a full departure. Because these special books and these marriage seminars that's not of the body of Christ, they can't help you like Jesus can help you. Everything you spend, everything you do, it only gets worse. Maybe your church family is hurting and you're hopping from church to church. And these problems keep falling. Maybe you the problem. If you haven't came to the realization and say, Lord, I need you to help me, Lord. Help me in my situation. Help me to be a wife, Lord, and a mother that you want me to be. I know what the Bible says in Proverbs 22, verse 6, train up a child the way he should go, and he's older, he will not depart from it. I know I need to teach my kids. I know I need to show an example for my kids. Lord, I need you to help me. I know these people are doing me wrong, Lord. They haven't been showing me love each chance they get. They've been talking about me, Lord. I know that, Lord. But Lord, I ain't worried about them. I know I'm supposed to forgive them, Lord. Lord, I need you to give me strength, Lord. Lord, I need you to help me. When Paul says, I forget those things that are behind me, Paul realized he had some baggage in his life. When Paul says, man, I forget those things that are behind me, I'm not worried about the issue I used to have. I'm not worried about the bad husband I used to be. I'm worried about the husband that I am right now. I'm not worried about those things because I'm trying to get to the prize. I'm trying to get to heaven. And I know if I just endure this, the Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 12, it says, blessed is the man who endures temptation, but when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. So I'm trying to get that crown. I know people will try to bring up my past. I know people go to, well, you know, he didn't come to Wednesday night Bible study 2 weeks ago. I ain't worried about that. Because I'm trying to reach the prize. I know I had an issue. But I know that my issue is not my issue no more. Because I know the source that delivered me from my issue. It reminds me of this orange, this old beat up, tore up orange. You sit this orange around beautiful oranges, people will look over this beat up orange because it doesn't look appealing to the eye. It looks worthless. But this old beat up orange with issues. God can take this old beat up orange with issues and peel all these jacked up and messed up issues.
Come on now.
And get to the source.
Yeah, I see.
If we don't realize that we have issues, these issues may prevent us from getting to the other side. The Bible says in Hebrews 10, 26, if we sin willfully after accepting the knowledge of truth, there remains no more sacrifice. The Bible talks about in 1 John chapter 5, verse 16 and 17, it talks about two types of sin, a sin unto death and a sin not unto death. Now the sin that's not unto death is a sin I commit. I know I got an issue. I know I got a lying issue, and I'm content with it, and I'm messing up. I'm doing all these things. But then Brother Ahmad and Brother Brandon, they come to me, and they say, man, Sahdiq, man, you got these issues. You need to change this, man. You need to repent. You need to get it right. And then I come like a prodigal son. I come to myself, and I say, you know what? I need to repent. The Bible says true repentance brings godly sorrow. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10. The Bible says true repentance brings godly sorrow, but worldly repentance brings death. So I repent. I comfort myself. So that sin that I was in, God, watch me. But now, this sin unto death, I commit this sin. I'm still in sin. I got this issue. And I'm content with this issue. Oh, man, I ain't tripping on that. That's y'all. I ain't worried about me. I don't want to repent of nothing. And I die in that sin.
Yeah, yeah.
That sin cannot be forgiven. See, we don't know what God will do. I mean, God can either allow you to be in your situation like he did a man in John chapter 5 for 38 years. He was in that situation for 38 years until he came in contact with Jesus. Or he can allow you to be like Ananias. You lie right there, you die right there. You don't know. So if we haven't came to the realization and said, Lord, I need you to help me. How is it that we're the only church that's in the Bible and we're not connected? We don't have real full fellowship because we don't have real full relationship with each other. We have issues, church. We need to come together. We need to have more programs like the woman's ride so the older woman can teach the younger woman how to love. The older man can teach the younger man how to be a man of God.
Yes, sir.
Lord, I need you to help me. Help me make a full decision so I can make a full departure. So I can appreciate God's dynamic delivery. The man who had the issue of the lesions. Man, he wanted to ride with Jesus, but Jesus said, man, go tell your friends and family what I did for you. Not only that, but tell them how much compassion I had for you. God will deliver us from something, and we close it in, and we don't want to tell nobody.
Come on.
How can we be a testimony, and we don't want to share the word? Because, man, you know what? I'm not good at talking to people. I'm shy. I'm trying to get to heaven.
Yes, sir.
See, I understand this. As we sit here together, sit in the pews, but this may be the last time. So this may be the last time, the last opportunity you get to repent, to get it right. This may be the last time you hear Brandon, Brother Brandon's voice singing. This may be the last time you may see that memory that you ain't spoke to in years. And dying that this may be the last time. I don't know. This may be the last time that you tell your wife, maybe I love you. a lie. And if your lie is that you don't believe that you have an issue, your issue may be lying.
Judgmental, though. When you realize how good God's been to you, people will see the joy in you.
know how people act if they got delivered from the issue. See, you may not even deliver from that issue. And it's still hanging on. But why play brush with that with your soul? James opened this issue in James chapter 4. When these men have this braggadocious mindset, man, this is what we go do. We go buy some property, we go have good games, we go do some things. And James is saying, how are you going to say that? Where is it? What should be the moral? What is your life? Your life is like a vapor here for a little while, then vanish away. You don't know. The next day may come. You don't know when the next hour may come. God can say, you know what? I'm tired. So while the blood runs warm in your veins, you need to praise and thank God. Because the best thing that God has did for us, he sent his son to die for us in our place. So while we have the opportunity to be restored, while we have the opportunity to be added to his church, we need to jump on it. You know, let somebody say, I have a book right here of $1 million, yours, tax-free. Then you have a big time. Because they see that money as the key of solving their issues. Maybe if I get all that money, I can buy my wife what she wants. She'd be happy. Maybe if I get all that money, I can buy me some houses. Maybe if I get that money to buy a nice car, then my issues will be solved. But you know what? That money will run out. And everything you do just go get worse. But Jesus is the only one who can make you whole. See, when he makes you whole, man, you just feel good. Man, this woman had this mindset for 12 years. 4,380 days, I'm by myself. Every time somebody look at me, there she go. Don't touch her. And hold up, and God just delivered me from this situation? And now I'm supposed to be silent? I ain't gonna tell nobody? Because people gonna look at me funny. Shh. Man, I'm gonna share the world. I'm gonna tell my friends. I'm going to tell my co-workers, I'm going to tell my classmates, let me introduce you to this man called Jesus. But see, what's happening is that we're not studying. The Bible says, study to show thyself a good work that you're not to be ashamed. Writing the Bible, the word of truth. I got to be in this word. In Psalms 1, David is saying, I meditate day and night. And this meditation, this is the meditation David is talking about, is that the word of God is just so good, I eat it. And then I have to regurgitate it and eat it again because it was just so good. See, how many times we come to Bible study, Sunday school, and morning worship, and we don't even have no pen and paper to take notes? Because what happens as soon as the doors is open, man, the devil will attack my mind. See, Paul deal with this issue in Romans chapter 7. The things that I'm supposed to do, I don't do it. I know I need to come up and ask a prayer, but you know, I just don't do it. I know I got an issue, but I don't want to identify that issue. I know I need to reconcile that relationship. I know I need to make myself available for the Lord's house, but I just don't do it. And the things that I'm not supposed to do, I do. I get mad every now and then, I cuss. I drink every now and then. I'm not saying me. The things that I'm not supposed to do, I know I don't come back to evening worship. I have no solid reason why I don't do it. Even though the Bible speaks to that in Hebrews 10:25. I know. But then Paul says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the principality. Paul said, what you need to do is put on this full armor of God. See, once you've been delivered from these issues, then that's when your full armor of God come on. So these issues won't attack you again. So this morning, church, do we have issues? Or do we have too much pride to say, See, what gets me, if we're many members in one body, if I bump my toe, my hands gonna come down and caress my toe because my hands got a relationship with my toe. Now, if I bump my toe and my hands don't want to do nothing, that means it gets out of fellowship. Or I'm crazy. And that's what God is saying. Watch this. In 1 John chapter 6, if we say we walk in the light, or we walk in darkness, we are alive, and the truth is not in us. But if we have fellowship with one another, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. If we come in here, this with our suit and tie, and our beautiful dress, and our hair all hooked up and stuff like that, and that's it. And it ain't no fellowship. There ain't no concern of my brother and sister in need. Man, we walk in darkness. Hold on, man, my brother is having issues in the spirit. Let's pray for him. Because I want the brother to get to heaven, but I want the same mindset. He want me to get to heaven. But somebody will come up here for prayer and we, man, look at him. He always coming up in here. Look at her. Look at her. That's what we do. We the modern day Pharisees and Sadducees.
Come on, Sahdiq.
Lord, I need you. Now, I remember in Acts chapter 8, when the Spirit of God sent Philip to the eunuch. The eunuch is in the chariot, and he's reading, and this eunuch was a man considered to be of power. He was under the Queen Candace. And the eunuch is reading the book of Isaiah about the sheep being led to the slaughter. So Philip comes to him and says, "Sir, do you understand what you're reading?" And the eunuch could have easily said, "Man, get away from me. I'm cool. I'm going to do my own thing." But the eunuch had a humble heart and said, "How can I understand unless a man teach me?" So Philip at the time taught him Jesus. Now when he taught him Jesus, he taught him about the one church. Matthew 16:18, Jesus said, "I will build my church." He told him that you need to be baptized for the remission of your sins. So after he got through teaching the eunuch this thing, the eunuch said, "Wait a minute, man, there goes some water. I'm ready to be healed from my issue. I'm not going to allow nobody to tell me when I'm ready, because I know when I'm ready to be healed from this issue." Then the Bible says that Philip baptized the eunuch, and they both went down to the water, and when the eunuch came up, he was shouting and praising with joy. Once you baptize, Acts 2:47, you be added to the church. Not only be added to the church, you be added to the body. Once you're added to the body, then God can hear your prayers. Then you're able to put on the full armor of God. But if you already been baptized, and you kind of stray away a little bit, you feel like the prodigal son. The prodigal son, the Bible said, he came to himself. He remembered how good it was at my father's house. See, sometimes we got to go back in our minds and remember just how good God has been to us. How God has delivered us from a situation that we thought we could never get out of. We need to go back to that time so we can realize how good we have and how good we can continue to have if we get right. Lord, I need you to help. Help me be a better wife. Help me be a better husband. Help me be better children to my parents. Help me be a better Christian. A better servant in your kingdom. I mean, man, if we can't ask that prayer, something wrong. We should ask that prayer daily. We got to let go of this prideful mindset. We all need prayer. Pray for me. Pray for me that I keep on keeping on. Pray for me that I endure this race to the end. Even when I feel tired and I feel weary, pray for me that I keep on keeping on. Not only for me, but for my household. Yes. Keep me in prayer. Man, if you think this Christian walk is easy, you got another thing coming. The Bible says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Church, we got to renew our mind. Lord, I need you. Let us all stand.